Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Richard Walls, Strategic Technical Advisor in the Advanced Air Vehicles Program of the National Aeronautics Research Mission Directorate and Aviation 2015 General Chair.
It's pretty grand hearing the voice of God like that, I must say. But so, anyway, good morning and welcome to day three of Aviation 2015. I want to start this morning by thanking each and every one of you for attending the forum. Over 2,000 of you have made the choice to be here with your fellow professionals, and that has no doubt led to some very good things: increased knowledge, shared ideas, new friendships and partnerships, and the furthering of the spirit of exploration that pushes us all forward. Your energy and curiosity and enthusiasm have made these first 2 days fly by fast. I also want to thank AIAA for their steadfast commitment to our community to shape the future of aerospace. From convening these forums, to giving us a publishing outfit, to promoting, mentoring, and networking, and other interactions that benefit us in so many ways, AIAA is such an important part of our profession, blending the right mix of academia, government, and industry representatives. AIAA is the bedrock that our community is built on. I do hope people have been taking advantage of the mini receptions and networking events. I've been to a number of them, and they're great. So if you haven't been to one, find one and go to it. Let me also take this opportunity to sincerely thank the sponsors of Aviation 2015. Special thanks to our premier sponsor, Airbus, and sponsors Bastion Technologies, The Boeing Company, Crane & Associates Aerospace Consultants, Dunmore, HondaJet, Lockheed, TMAC, and X-Flow. Also Aerospace America, our media sponsor. Two housekeeping items. As a reminder, first, as you saw on the pre-plenary slides, when you have a question for our speakers in a plenary or a Forum 360 session, please direct a web browser to our new conferences I.O. site at aiaa1.cnf.io. You'll be able to submit and vote for your favorite questions. Charlie says any question's good. He'll try to answer anyone here. So log on now. Don't wait and think of questions as it goes along. Those watching live stream can do the same. Second, all of our speakers' biographies can be read by visiting the Aviation Forum website at AIAA-aviation.org/speakers. Okay, now the good stuff, right? When most people think about NASA, space is the first thing that comes to mind. Some tend to forget that NASA is the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, and that since 1915 it has been engaged in groundbreaking scientific research on flight and flight technology, first as the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics and then as NASA. Aeronautics has always been a core research focus of the organization and one that I've personally been proud to be part of. And that work has given us so much of what I take for granted on aircraft today: improved wings, more dependable and more environmentally friendly engines, and a better understanding of transonic flight, and a better understanding of the air traffic management strategies, and so much more. To take us through the latest achievements of NASA Aeronautics, and to give us a glimpse into the future as well, please welcome NASA Administrator Charlie Bolden.
Thanks very much, Richard. Thank you. Well, thanks very much, Richard, and thanks, Sandy, for the invitation to come. This is incredible. When I was out in Los Angeles, I think 2 years ago, I had a really good time. I think most of you know, by background, I'm a pilot. I wish I could say I'm still a pilot. Don't get to fly anymore, and I hate to admit it, but I have three beautiful I don't hate to admit this. I have three beautiful granddaughters, and so what I do hate to admit is they have really taken my mind off aviation and flying and stuff, so I don't miss it because I'm busy with them. But let me say good morning to Aviation 2015. It is a great, great day to be here in Dallas and to be in the aerospace community. Since I know this is being streaming and everything, I want to give a shout out to my new deputy administrator, Dr. Dava Newman. Dava may or may not be looking in. Some of you who know Dava, and those of you who don't, I hope you have an opportunity to meet her very, very soon because she's awesome. She is a lover of aeronautics. She was a professor of aeronautics and astronautics at MIT when the president decided to nominate her to be the deputy. And I'm jealous because she was able to go down to Langley last week when Boeing flew the 757 Eco Demonstrator in, and she got to play with the airplane the way that I was really looking forward to doing. So Deva, if you're listening, you got to come out and meet everybody, and you owe me for letting you go down to Langley last week. We have quite a few members, as a matter of fact, of Team NASA at this conference, and I hope in particular that all of you will stick around to hear from Dr. Jaewon Shin, who runs NASA's Aeronautics Mission Directorate, and Bob Pierce, our Director for Strategy, Architecture, and Analysis. They'll be participating at Forum 360 later on this morning. I think it actually starts at 9:30 or something. Okay, everybody says yes. Pamela says yes. So don't go too far. Get coffee or something, and then come back to Forum 360. And then trust me, you won't want to miss it. And there you will get real information. I don't know what you call it. The what? Oh, I'm the prequel? Okay. The precursor, prequel, whatever you want to call it. So hopefully I will whet your appetite. To everyone with AIAA, thank you for putting on such an outstanding conference, as you always do, and for all the work you do on behalf of our field. As a, and I still call myself a pilot, so as a pilot myself, your work has always been near and dear to my heart. I believe I saw a few of you last week, as a matter of fact, at the Paris Air Show, where I didn't get to see very many airplanes. I never do. I hear them as I'm sitting in all my meetings, but that's just the price you pay for being in NASA and trying to meet lots of people. I must say that feeling the energy there and sensing the energy in this room, walking around last night when we got in and watching some of you converse about the sessions and everything else, particularly watching the new career persons, those who are either students right now or who are just newly hired into the aerospace field, it's exciting watching you and your enthusiasm. And I think it's the hope of all of us in leadership roles in this industry that you never, ever, ever lose the enthusiasm that you have right now. You will have difficult times ahead. When you do, I'd ask you to pause for a minute and think back to right now when you made your decision that, you know, this was going to be the field that you were going to go into. Remember when it gets difficult why you decided to come into this field. And I think that may help get you over the hump because, you know, we have ups and downs. That's just the nature of this field. But it always comes back. And we always, always, always do great things. You know, this is a reminder to me of what an exciting time it is to be working in the aerospace field. I can tell you that there are about 1.5 trillion reasons why I say that. Now, I know you know this, but as one of my inspirations and mentors, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., is said to have taught, sometimes it's important to preach to the choir because otherwise they might stop singing. So I'm going to preach to you a little bit today, stuff that you already know, but it's because I want you never to stop singing our song. Aviation generates more than $1.5 trillion. That's trillion with a T, in economic activity each year. It supports more than 11.8 million jobs, both directly and indirectly. And as an engine of commerce, it transports 18.1 billion tons of freight each and every year. Although my French is more than a little rusty. I don't know any. So I'm going to take a shot at this. I believe the term in French is une grosse affaire. Who's the French speaker here? Close? No? Nobody knows French? Is there nobody from Caness or any of that stuff here? Come on, fess up. Who took high school French? Okay, is that close? Don't know? That's close. Okay, let me stay with that. That's like my high school German. I don't know a thing. In English, it means it's a big deal. So that's all you have to remember. I always enjoy coming to this event. I was with you last in 2013, as I mentioned earlier, and Those of you who were with us then, or with whom I have had the pleasure of meeting since, have probably heard me say, and I love saying this, NASA is with you when you fly. And unlike jet lag, we're here in a good way. I say that because every American aircraft and every American air traffic control tower is equipped with technology that was developed by NASA. These technologies save lives, save resources, and in fact, when you consider the impact that green aviation can have on our environment, I think it's fair to say that they're saving our planet as well. Just last week, our friends from Boeing flew their eco demonstrator plane up, down, actually, over, from Washington State to the Langley Research Center. For the past several years, we've partnered with them to test several technologies. In one of my personal favorite examples, we flight tested nonstick coatings formulated to reduce the buildup of residue from, I believe the scientific term is bug guts, on the leading edges of aircraft wings. One of these coatings actually reduced bug residue by 40% versus normal control surfaces. If we're able to deploy effective nonstick coatings across the board, it could save fuel and money, not to mention a lot of bug lives. The bottom line is that if you're working on efficiency, if you're working on green aviation, if you're working to reduce noise and increase safety, and I know that you are, then we at NASA want to work with you. Our goal is not only to be with you when you fly, but as you innovate in flight. Now, a lot has happened in the last 2 years. You know, when you're watching a television show, they give you a few scenes from previous episodes. So this is the part of our program this morning when I get to remind you that when we last met at this conference, I talked about where we're headed at NASA in terms of aviation research. I talked about safe, efficient growth in global operations, innovation in commercial supersonic aircraft, ultra-efficient commercial vehicles, and transitioning to low-carbon propulsion. We also spoke about NASA's research into real-time system-wide safety assurance, as well as unmanned aircraft systems, or UASs, an area where NASA is doing work that nobody else is doing. That was when I rolled out, or J1 actually rolled out NASA's new aeronautics strategic plan and talked about the six areas of strategic thrust. A lot has happened since then. Thanks in large part to our partnerships with a number of your companies and organizations, we've made some very real progress in all these areas. Now, I could run through all of them, but I don't want to still be talking when my friends J1 and Bob walk out of here to start their panel. So I'm gonna try not to talk too long. I'd be a lousy opening act. Prequel. Where did my prequel person go? There she is. I would be a lousy opening act if I put all of you to sleep before their turn to take the mic. Instead, what I thought I'd do is highlight just a few areas that I think will be of particular interest. And if you have interest in a few other areas, we can get to them during the Q&A. The first regards the first research thrust I mentioned, safety and efficiency. These are priorities we can all get behind, and in fact, we all do. When it comes to safe, efficient growth in global operations, I have some big news to share, and some of you may have actually read it in the news clips this morning. Today, we're able to announce that our friends and partners at the Federal Aviation Administration, or the FAA, are moving forward with a full investment decision on what we call terminal sequencing and spacing, or TSAS. That's a really fancy name for what is a very valuable piece of computer software. It's designed to help air traffic controllers manage aerospace within 5 miles from a major airport. Here's the really exciting news. It will help pilots to fly continuous descent, fuel-efficient approaches toward the airport. What's more, it will safely permit more flights to merge together at a point where they can be cleared for final approach and landing. The airlines, they stand to save money from this in fuel expenses. The air we breathe, it will get more clean as we reduce emissions. All of us stand to benefit as we reduce air traffic congestions and also ease the workload of our friends in air traffic control. The FAA's plan to deploy TSAS began between 2018 and 2022 to 9 major international airports located in Phoenix, Houston, Atlanta, Seattle, San Francisco, Las Vegas, Charlotte, Denver, and LA. This sets the stage for full-scale implementation. Eventually, we want to see TSAS implemented across our entire national airspace system. And J1 and his team are actually working a number of international collaborations where, to be quite honest, we'd like to see TSAS and other tools that we're employing implemented across the world to smooth the flow of traffic worldwide. So that's some exciting news when it comes to safety and efficiency. I also wanted to give you an update on another area where we're reaching some fairly exciting heights. Show of hands, and I think I can see from here, are there any of you in this room who are grandparents like I am? A few of you. How about parents? Oh, a lot more. All right. When we think about the sort of world we'll leave to our children and grandchildren and their children and grandchildren, I think all of us can agree that they ought to be able to breathe clean air or live in a world that's not devastated by the effects of changing climate. You might have seen Pope Francis's, Pope Francis wrote in his encyclical on the environment this month. And not intending to start a political debate here, but I do want to quote it. And I quote, "Never have we so hurt and mistreated our common home as we have in the last 200 years. Yet all is not lost. Human beings, while capable of worst, are also capable of rising above themselves, choosing again what is good and making a new start," unquote. It's for this reason that any conversation about the future of aviation has to begin with green aviation. Over the last 6 years, NASA invested $410 million in what we call our environmentally responsible aviation project. And you know what? We didn't go it alone. You and your colleagues invested an additional $224 million also. That's what we know of, $224 million from industry. 8 major projects have come out of this research, and taken together, they could help us realize over 80 billion gallons of fuel saved through 2050. This would not only result in saving the airlines and travelers hundreds of billions in expenses, it could save the environment from almost 1 billion with a B, tons of CO2 emissions. Before I wrap up, I have just one more area that I wanted to discuss with you, and that's commercial supersonic aircraft. Those of you who fly a lot, like I used to do, I still do, but I'm in a seat in the back. You know that as amazing as it is to be able to fly across the globe in 12, 13, 14 hours, it's also exhausting, and it takes a toll on our productivity. We've been flying subsonic for so long, it's easy to think that this is as fast as we'll ever travel, short of teleportation. The one foray into commercial supersonic flight, the Concorde, never materialized as a real transportation solution. While the will and the business case for flying supersonic may have faltered, the technology to make it happen hasn't. We at NASA are working to solve the sonic boom problem so industry can start innovating in supersonic transportation. David McBride is here from the Armstrong Flight Research Center. As is David Bowles from Langley and Janet Cavandi representing Glenn. And I think the centers that represent aeronautics and NASA, they should all be proud of the incredible work that we have been doing through the years with low-boom supersonics. It primarily done out at Armstrong, where the actual flight test occurred. As you may know, our scientists have developed the computational methods to accurately design aircraft shape to minimize the boom. So far, we've validated the methods and design in wind tunnel tests. On the industry side, it looks like the teams working on low-boom flight demonstration designs can beat the low-boom target. My hope, therefore, is that we can form a partnership with you and your colleagues in industry to actually build and fly the demonstrator. We have a request for information out right now, and we'll have an industry day next month to see if together we can move this forward. And let me not kid anybody. This is difficult. It's difficult technically, but more important, it's difficult politically. We've got a battle on both ends of Pennsylvania Avenue when it comes to having people believe in what we believe in terms of supersonic flight over ground. I'm passionate about it. I think those of you who have worked with me through the years know that I am. This is something that I think we have an obligation to do, not just for the American public, but for the public around the world in general. So we're going to work with industry and academia and all people in trying to bring this to fruition. I truly believe that the day will come when the prohibition against supersonic flight over land is no longer necessary, when a low boom signature is no longer a dream, but a reality. These are just a few of the areas where we're making tremendous progress. And as I said a moment ago, if you have questions or some of the others, I'm happy to try to tackle them during our Q&A coming up. And if I can't answer it, I got a lot of NASA folk down here who more than likely can. At the end of the day, this is a great time to be working in the field of aerospace. As someone who works on both the aviation side and the space side of aerospace, I can attest that the progress we're making in our own atmosphere is empowering our journey to Mars and beyond. In fact, we're actually closer to Mars, in my belief, than ever before in human history. And if you look at what's been going on, there's a new consensus that's emerging around NASA's plan and timetable for sending American astronauts to the Red Planet by the 2030s. Again, thanks to all of you for choosing our field, the aerospace field. Thanks to all of you for coming out for this incredible conference and for supporting AIAA and in so doing supporting aeronautics. I look forward to answering, hopefully, questions that will now come up. So I think we're ready. Thank you very much.
Getting lots of questions. Thank you, Charlie. No fear, there's lots of questions. I can tell you that we have more questions at this point in the session than we have the other days, so that means people are signing on. I'm going to combine the first two questions and go straight to what's utmost in people's mind, budget.
Yeah.
And I want to read both of them just because they give you a sense of what's about. One is, how can we help NASA return to the aeronautics budget to its 1990 levels, twice the current levels? And in light of how many people fly in space every day and how many people fly on airplanes every day, why is the aeronautics budget so small?
Yeah, both good questions. And you know, I think when I said we've got a political battle, I have to admit, I for one was shocked, to be quite honest, when we looked at the marks that came out of both House and Senate, but particularly Senate, you know, over the last few weeks. We actually thought when we got the final marks for the 2015 budget, when we saw a significant increase of $100 million in the aeronautics budget, that we had turned the curve and we were on our way back to respectable budgets in aeronautics, and then somebody pulled the rug out from under us. But we continue to negotiate and converse with Congress and try to help them understand the critical importance of what was the crux of the question is, aeronautics is the future. It is in fact the big A in NASA, and that's why I say we have a true responsibility to make sure that we continue to fight for the advances in aeronautics that we think we can do. I'll tell you one thing. I had a meeting with all my counterparts on the International Space Station partners at the Paris Air Show, with the exception of the Canadians. And as I was leaving my last meeting with Jean-Jacques Dardenne, who is the head of the outgoing head of the European Space Agency, I did as I always do. I asked him, okay, where do you guys want to go? What do you want to do? Meaning in exploration. And he said, it's the same as I've always said. We want to go where you go. Everybody's going to follow the United States. And he emphasized that. He said, you know, he gave me a lecture, which was deserved. He said, you don't have a choice. You and the U.S. don't have a choice. The world expects you to lead. And so what we've got to do is help convince the Congress and the administration, not one or the other, but both, that our responsibility is to continue to lead in aeronautics, because you don't just get where we are at the top of our game and stay there by going stagnant. So we'll continue to carry that message and see what we can do.
Are there ways this community can help?
There sure are, and I'll tell you what, if you go back to 2013 to Aviation 2013, when I spoke, and I complained that you all were too quiet. People stopped being quiet, to be quite honest. And you know, as I said then, the space community is very vocal. The science community is exceptionally vocal. And when you look at the budgets, you see the results of that vocal nature in those communities. It's our job to help inform the members of Congress and people like me in the administration of what's important to the nation from your perspective. And so you can't sit idly by and watch the money be heaped into other areas of NASA's budget and watch the money go away from aeronautics. You know, you have an obligation to go to your local members and say, hey, what's up with this? And tell them what you know to be fact. Take them some of the information that you gain from this. But those of you who travel around the world and interact with people from around the world, help them understand, because they don't, to be quite honest, they don't have the passion and the pride in this nation that I do. Now, that's going to really torque some people off. But it really torques me off to see leaders of this nation complain that we are no longer leading. We are behind someone. That's crap, to put it mildly. There is no one as good as we are. And there's no one who will ever be as good as we are as long as we stay on our game and as long as we stay aggressive and push and do the kinds of things that we know only we can do. You know, there are other countries who are trying to, they're watching what we do in low boom supersonics, believe it or not. And they're stepping out and they're taking whatever they can learn from what we've done and they're gonna move with it. The Europeans are gonna move with supersonic transport whether we like it or not, because most of their flight's over water and they really don't care. You know, they don't have the problem that we have. We can't shirk from the position of leadership that is ours, you know, no matter what you say. So anybody who walks out of here and doesn't stick their chest out about being a part of U.S. aeronautics, something's wrong. You cannot possibly leave a forum like this and see what you see and hear what you hear. And for those of you who are students or people giving papers, you can't walk out of here and not feel a sense of pride of what you have achieved, whether it's in your undergraduate studies or your graduate studies or in your work day in and day out, because we do great stuff and we just need to be proud of it.
Well, I know this community can be vocal, so we need to keep being vocal to help you help us. All right, so you mentioned students. The next, one of the next areas is, what is your vision of the new develops in aeronautics that will create excitement and draw young people to the industry? And there's a related question that talks about the shortage of engineering skills.
Yeah. I think the thing that draws people to our industry is the ability to do stuff, to put hands on machines, if you will, or do computational fluid dynamics and then see it carried out and put into some aircraft or spacecraft or whatever it is. The kind of work that's being done in industry. Our job at NASA, because 85% of our budget, I think most of you know, 85% of our budget, boom, it just goes right through into industry, academia, entrepreneurs, and the like. A very small portion of it is spent in-house in NASA. So we have got to continue to push the need for STEM education, the critical importance in our young people to want to work in STEM fields. What I tell kids all the time is you cannot beat giving yourself a basic STEM background. Science, engineering, math, you can go off and become an attorney. You can go off and become a writer. You can go off and become anything you want to with a strong STEM background. The one advantage that it gives you that others who don't do that can't is they can't change their mind late and decide that, okay, I really like this stuff. I really like this technical stuff. I did that. You know, when I went to the Naval Academy, I left high school. I have done nothing, zero, in my adult life that I dreamed of doing when I came out of high school. I graduated from high school in Columbia, South Carolina. And I'd always wanted to go to the Naval Academy, always, since seventh grade. You know, and I noticed it was interesting when, and this is really off the subject here, but I am from South Carolina, so I've been very interested in everything that's been going on since the tragic deaths in Charleston last week. But I found it incredibly interesting and remarkable that the son of Strom Thurmond, a person who wouldn't give me an appointment to the Naval Academy, when I was in high school, but who my mother was convinced, you know, deep down somewhere, was always behind the scenes in helping to promote my development and my move. Because every single time in my life that I did anything, from the moment I went to the Naval Academy, I always got a note from Senator Thurmond. Really strange. And then yesterday or day before yesterday, his son spoke so eloquently on the floor of the South Carolina legislature, you know, about issues down there and about coming together and stuff, which was diametrically opposed from the way his father, you know, spoke openly and publicly. So I just think we've got to get kids interested in what we do. And we've got to give them opportunities to put their hands on stuff. Bring them in as interns. Bring them in as co-ops. First Robotics, those kinds of programs that allow them to do things. It doesn't cost very much for us to sponsor those kinds of programs. The big thing is your time, to be quite honest, because it's cheap financially. It costs you some time to be a mentor. So those are some of the things we have to do.
Okay, great. Top of the list now. How do you want to bring the X-plane culture back to NASA? Part of the excitement factor.
We're starting with the low boom supersonic demonstrator is the thing we're really, really, really trying to push. Several of you here, whether it's Lockheed, Boeing, Gulfstream, kind of nibble around the edges, letting us know you're interested. And we keep working very hard to try to find an optimal way to get industry involved. We've just got to keep pushing together, industry mainly, going in and saying, hey, this is something that's really going to benefit us, and we would like to take advantage of the preliminary work that NASA has done. We fly little experimental things right now, whether UASs, we're doing a lot of work in the unmanned aerial system arena, because we're trying to help the FAA, trying to help them as they try to catch up with the rest of the world, you know, in writing regulations that allow UASs more latitude, more ways to get into the national airspace system. But, you know, it's our responsibility to try to support you in the things that you want. We think we did that when we changed our aeronautics strategic plan several years ago. When we adopted those six strategic thrust areas, we thought we were listening to you, and hope we are. So, you know, if we're going astray, because you're our customer. Aeronautics is the one area in NASA that doesn't have, you know, its own projects that it does for itself, for the most part. It's all of you sitting here in this audience. So Jaywan and Dave and David and everybody else around the NASA community, we're always trying to listen to what it is you say you want us to do and trying to figure out ways to do that. So you got to let us know if we're on the right track. And also, if we stray, then we also need to know that.
So I know you have to, and you and Jaywan, go to get budget for those kind of things. Is there anything we can do to help you guys?
Yeah.
Convince the people with the pocketbooks.
Keep talking. Just don't get discouraged. I look at Sandy. Sandy is talking a lot to members and staff. It is tedious. And Sandy, you got a different idea. I mean, it's just tedious work. And you just have to be persistent. And you have to keep going in and delivering your message, and try to stay on message. You know, sometimes we're our own worst enemy, because we go in with a new idea every day. And in the aeronautics field, I don't think we've done that. I think we've been very persistent. You know, we're working on supersonic flight. We're working on hypersonics. For those of you who work in the classified area, we're doing a lot of work to try to help everyone, whether it's in the Pentagon or in the Congress or in the White House, understand that we're really being challenged in the area of hypersonics. And in NASA, we believe that we have the resident expertise in the nation for fundamental hypersonic research. You would think that'd be a piece of cake. That's hard, convincing people that we need to stay at it and things like that. So we've just got to be persistent in the messages that we all deliver. So, you know, pick a topic and stay on it, and just don't give up and don't back down.
Okay. I think this next question it's related, but how can the aviation industry become less conservative and be prepared to take more risk when it comes to innovation? And I know being conservative is kind of in the eye of the beholder.
I was going to say, I'm accused all the time of being risk averse. I don't think we're risk averse at all. But then it's in, as you said, it's in the eye of the beholder. When you look at the work, and I don't want to pick anybody out in particular, but I have to pick out Boeing in this particular case, because when you look at the Eco Demonstrator and the work that's being done, for example, on the active flow, trying to reduce the size of the vertical tail on an airplane, which creates an incredible amount of drag. You look at the big damn tails we got on these airplanes, just to give them yaw stability and stuff like that. If we can find a way to use bleed air off the engine to provide flow that helps with directional control and reduce the size of the tail, man, think about the fuel savings. Think about the efficiency in the airplane. So I think that's risky stuff they're doing, especially if they decide that they're going to follow through and they're really going to start reducing the size of the tail. So I think you all are doing aggressive, risk-taking things, but just keep doing it.
Yeah.
That's all I can say.
All right, the next one that's bubbled to the top. The funding model, I know this is near and dear to a lot of people's hearts here, but the funding model for NASA research facilities is broken. Wind tunnels especially are not being maintained, and there may not be there to meet future needs. A new funding model is needed. Is there any hope for that?
Yes, there is, and I wish Lisa Rowe were here. Dave, you guys speak up if I get it wrong. I'm going to try to. I don't do facilities and stuff. I should not say that. I have the most incredible leadership team: Robert Lightfoot, Lisa Rowe, David Newman, on down the line. And so we have what's called, what's NBA, non-budget activities, and they are things that NASA needs to do no matter what. I mean, no matter how much money we get, these are things that we really have to do. Our facilities. We have got to find ways to modernize and upgrade our facilities. And one of the proposals on which we're working is a way to finally get enough funding that we, NASA, can run facilities. We can maintain wind tunnels and other test facilities so that a young student from Georgia Tech or MIT or somewhere else, or more importantly, one of our NASA engineers who has a bright idea and wants to just test it, can say, okay, I need time and I'd like to use the 8-foot wind tunnel at Langley. And because that tunnel is a part of our basic infrastructure that is already paid for, already has the technicians there, they don't have to pay for it. It's a facility that's available there. Now the funding model that we use for big customers who come in, that we'll work that out. But we want to get to the point where the facilities are available and open all the time for anybody who wants to use them. We want them to be national facilities, national capabilities, if you will. Is that a pipe dream? I don't think so. But Lisa and her team are really working pretty hard. So when we get to the 360, somebody, Dave, are you on the panel? Okay, there's a Senate Directors group that's doing a panel. Ask the people who know. I'm not the person who knows. I watch them, and I'm amazed at what they're doing, but they can give you details about how we're trying to do this stuff. Right. These guys are incredible, by the way. Dave Bowles, where's David McBride? David McBride's back there somewhere, right over here. Janet Cavandi, who's here from Glenn. And I don't know whether there are any other Senate Directors here. They're mayors. That's what, in your town where you live, and the mayor, you hold the mayor responsible when the water main breaks and all that. That's what they do. They run the town. And in some cases, they actually run a town that has a lot more people than NASA that are residents. And they do an incredible job. So my hat's off to them. And hopefully you'll pummel them in the panel in the 360 session.
Form 360, 9:30, Grand Ballroom. Great. Let's see. There's another train of thought here. Let's see. Please comment on the benefits of international collaboration. There's one that says specifically Europe. There's one that specifically asks about Russia, and another about what about China in the future.
Yeah. I'm going to borrow water here, not because that question's got me first. International collaboration and cooperation is absolutely essential. We don't normally think about it in the area of aviation, because of all the restrictions about exchange of technology and the like. But there are other things that we do. For example, when you talk about air traffic management, getting from point A to point B, getting airplanes safely out of their en route structure down to the runway with systems like TSAS, those are things that we can, in fact, share and exchange with international partners. And Jaywan and his team have done an absolutely incredible job of going out and entering into memoranda of understanding and memoranda of agreement with as many of our international partners as we can. We're just going one by one and trying to get them to collaborate with us on unmanned aerial systems development, on but particularly in air traffic management, so that when an airplane takes off from somewhere in the US and flies to some other foreign airspace, the same systems are in use there, or at least systems that are compatible with ours, so that those of you who are in the airplane business, you don't have to have two or three systems on board because you're going from GPS in the US to whatever it is in China to whatever it is in Russia, such that those systems are compatible and to the airplane it's transparent as you go from point to point. So for us, when you talk about exploration, we're going to Mars, but we're not going to do it alone. We can't do it alone. If you look at the Space Launch System, the SLS, the Heavy Lift Launch Vehicle, a critical path item is the service module. That's the part that allows crews to survive for more than 21 days in Orion. That's being done by the Europeans. So it's being manufactured in Turin in Italy. If they don't produce, we don't produce. We don't go. And I think you're going to find more and more NASA's reaching out, trying to bring in more international partners that we, some with whom we have not worked in the past. Unfortunately, in my opinion, we're not allowed to cooperate bilaterally with China right now. I think that will change in time, but I think we lose an awful lot by not being able to do that. But there are very few internationals that with whom we can't collaborate, try to get the best of what they have and put it together with the best of what we have. So I think it's essential.
Okay, great.
Let me add one more thing, too. For some of you, NASA now has an international intern program. We did not have that until this year. So we can now, there a student from a non-U.S. student can now apply for some of the very limited international internships and actually come and work at a NASA center for an intern period. We couldn't do that before this year. That's a small start, but we're trying to find ways to get talent from other countries, you know, back here to want to go to school again and maybe to want to stay the way it used to be.
So along those lines, there's a question that was already in here. You mentioned co-op and internship programs, but those have been steadily reducing at NASA, is the perception. Any comments on that? And I will tell you that out of the over 2,000, there's almost 500 students here at this forum, which is excellent.
I'm going to defer to the center directors about the numbers of internships and co-ops. All I know is whenever I hear them talk about their interns for the summer, it's a lot of people. Now, it may be down. I don't know. But I'm going to defer to the center directors panel to get very specific. I know we don't have the funds we had before, so that naturally says then there are fewer students, but we still have a lot of students who are doing internships and co-ops.
Personally, I've seen it. I think we've turned a corner, and it's improving, I don't know all the numbers either. How is NASA collaborating with the FAA to help bring UAS into the NAS?
Boy, we are, you know, we're trying to help any and everyone who's trying to set up one of these six UAS test sites around the country that nobody knows. I don't want to say that. I think we know what we're doing. I'm not sure about others. Is that close, Jaywan? Yes? Okay. Very important. You know, we are trying to enter into partnerships with other people. Our job, we think, and I'm going to look for a yes or a no from Jaywan. We're focused on software development, on ways for unmanned aerial systems to be able to look around as if they have a pilot in the aircraft, and sense and then avoid things that are out there. So we're working on sense and avoid. We have incredible partnerships with like Google, other organizations that are looking at driving things around. You may say, well, why do we care? proximity warning systems, all of those types of things for a driverless car, we think also have applicability to a driverless aircraft that's flying around at 500 feet or whatever altitude the FAA is going to settle on is acceptable for unmanned aerial systems operations. And I think right now we're looking in the 1,500 feet and below range or something like that, if I'm not mistaken. But there's a lot of traffic there. And what we're trying to do is work with industry, academia, and everybody in helping to perfect the safety types of systems, the sense and avoid systems and others. The other thing that I think is incredible, what's my tin-bladed thing? What's the name of it?
Grease Lightning.
Grease Lightning. I love it. I should know the name. I think you're going to find something like Grease Lightning is going to generate a lot of interest in propulsion, in unmanned aerial systems. There is something in which I think we may be behind the Europeans, and that's electric airplanes. But we know where they are, and we're trying to pick up the pace so that we can catch up and then exceed them. But we just haven't, up until recently, we just had not done a lot of work there, but Grease Lightning is an absolutely incredible platform that's allowing us to look in an area where at least people didn't know NASA was looking before.
All right, from UAS to hypersonics. What do you see as the future, if any, for hypersonics research at NASA?
I am optimistic. I am the eternal optimist. I will say that. And this has been a long, since I've been the NASA administrator for 6 years now, it's been a long 6-year battle. I am optimistic that we are finally getting to the point where NASA, the Department of Defense, and other entities are beginning to talk to each other and recognize what we're all contributing. And I think we're going to be able to go to the administration and say, hey, we really count on those guys doing their part. We'll do our part. And what none of us knew before was what part were the others doing. I think we knew what everybody else was doing. Nobody knew that we weren't doing our part. And when I talk about doing our part, I'm just talking about basic funding for hypersonics research.
Right.
But it goes back to, again, Dave Bowles being able to maintain the hypersonic wind tunnel at Langley with the people who know more about fundamental hypersonics than anybody else in the world. We want to be able to bring students in there so that they can be mentored by this incredible group of people who could leave in a heartbeat and go anywhere they wanted to go, but they're really dedicated to serving the country and working in our facility. So we've got to be able to stabilize our funding for hypersonics. That's our big goal, so that we have the hypersonic wind tunnel is always available. The technical expertise that goes along with it is always available, and I think I'm optimistic that we're going to get there.
Okay, we're nearing the end here. The one that's far and away above the most asked question here. Why are the political battles about aeronautics so hard? Do members of Congress and staff not understand the issues? Which means maybe we're not conveying them properly. What makes it so hard?
I'm going to give you an opinion, and opinions are like butts. Everybody's got one, so at least I think we all do. And this is really my opinion. I just think we are so torn right now we're dysfunctional. We are so torn in these political battles, and actually it gets personal when you get right down to it. And we are not even willing to come together and say, okay, what's good for the country? And that was the thing I think that was most disappointing about the marks for the 2016 budget was we thought we were making progress, and then all of a sudden things just fell apart and went back into the old parochial, I got mine, I could care less about you. And that is an issue that has to be worked by us. And I tell people all the time, the answer to that problem is to vote. That's not anything about aeronautics. That's just plain old civics 101. If we don't vote and we don't talk to the people who represent us in the halls of Congress or in local legislatures, then we can't expect to get anything that we know needs to be done. They generally will respond to what you say. You know, if a Senate director, and these guys may not agree with me, our Senate directors have much more influence than I will ever have as the NASA administrator. And it's because they are the ones responsible for the 1,000 or 2,000 constituents for the members of this delegation. I don't have any of that, and they know that. So I can go in and talk to members, if they'll talk to me, to be quite honest, which is getting to be difficult. And I don't get very much response. When a Senate director goes in and says, hey, this is really going to impact us, we generally tend to at least get some attention and some people to listen to. And that's the reason I say you are their constituents. They know, or they hope, that you vote. And so that's the card that you can play. I don't know how many people are in this room, but in some communities, I mean, there are more people in this room than ever vote there. So you do have an impact when you go to the polls, and you do have an impact when you go and meet with a member, whether it's locally, in their local office, or their staff, or whatever. And the staffs are really the ones you have to work on, to be quite honest. I wish it was the member. So don't get too worked up, you know, if you don't have an opportunity to see the member every time you go. The staffs are incredibly influential, and they tend to be the ones that last. So, you know, find a staff member that's been there for a while and groom them and help them understand what we know to be, you know, to be facts about aeronautics and the value of aeronautics. And give them line, song, and verse on how much money, how many jobs, all that other kind of stuff, particularly if you can point out what's being done in their community, because they don't always know.
All right, I'm going to ask one more.
Okay.
What are some ways to infuse NASA and aeronautics in general with the enthusiasm that you obviously have? And I, for one, love your enthusiasm and glad you're working for us.
Every single one of you has to do what I love to do. You got to get out and you've got to get into the community and tell people what you do. And that sounds simple, but think about it. How often does your kid come home and say, hey, tomorrow is Parents' Day. Can you go? And if you're like I used to be, you say, I'd love to be there, but. Don't say but. In your life as a parent or grandparent, you have a lot of one only things that happen. Think about it. One time and it's gone. You know, I missed my middle granddaughter's graduation from sixth grade last week. That's terrible, because I will never get another chance to see her graduate from sixth grade. Now, is that a big deal? You bet it is.
Yeah.
To her. So you got to get into the community, and you've got to get in and tell people how passionate you are about what you do. And if you're not passionate about what you do, you're just doing a job, that's okay. But don't get in the way of people who want to do it. If you're a supervisor and you have a subordinate who comes in and says, can I get a few hours? Find a way to make it happen. I hear this thing all the time in NASA, well, I don't have a charge code. Bull crap. You know, call me. I'll make up a charge code or something. I don't know. But for an agency like the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, whose job, I spend $18 billion a year on STEM education. And I mean that. Every single thing that NASA does is about STEM education. And so if I can't find a way to let somebody go spend an hour in their kids' classroom to talk about what they do at the Langley Research Center or Armstrong or Johnson or somewhere else, I ought to be fired. I mean, just that blunt. So everybody in here just has to take an active interest in their community and go out and preach about what you, be proud of what you do and tell people. If your family doesn't know what you do, your kids, your grandkids, then something's wrong. You know, if they don't go into their classroom and say, my grandma or my granddad does this, something's wrong. You cannot be that closed about what you do or you can't feel that bad about what you do that you don't want to share it with your kids or your grandkids or somebody. So I think that's what I would say, dude.
Great.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. All right. I hope everybody feels inspired. I want to mention again the NASA panel at 9:30. There's a green aviation panel at 2 o'clock, Forum 360, that'll be in the same room. There's a Rising Leaders networking event at 3. And go forth and conquer. Engage.